Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. Let's begin by dissecting the news. A group of Duterte supporters is pushing for the tandem of Manila Mayor Isko Moreno and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte in the May presidential election. Moreno has his own running mate in Dr. Willie Ong under Aksyon Demokratiko. But it's not the first time in this ongoing campaign that certain groups wanted him partnered with Mayor Duterte, who is running for vice president. There are those who also toyed with the idea of electing Lenny Robredo for president and Sara Duterte for vice president. This, of course, is what happens when presidents and vice presidents are elected separately under the Philippine Constitution. In many cases, the two top elected officials coming from different parties or tickets and are not seeing eye to eye once in office. Now, here's the question. Should the Philippines now shift to tandem voting? Meaning, when you vote for a president, you automatically vote for his or her running mate. Now, be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight is Attorney Tony Lavinia. He is the former dean of the Ateneo School of Government. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program tonight.
Good evening, Christian, and good evening to everyone. Happy to be here, as always.
Thank you, sir. Let's help us make sense of this setup under the current constitution in the Philippines, where we don't have tandem voting. We elect presidents and vice presidents separately. What do you think was the wisdom behind this?
There is no wisdom behind it, except it reflects political reality in the country. And it reflects a system that we have, which is not political party oriented, nor is it platform oriented. It's personality oriented. So, they justify this by saying, when I say they, the framers of the Constitution, when they debated this, they justified it as saying that Filipinos like to vote for their candidates, like to vote for individuals, like to vote for their families. They don't like to vote for political parties, which I think is actually condescending. But in any case, that's the reason why. Our politics is a politics of personality and a politics of celebrities. And so we want to make a choice between by the way, as I said, that's condescending of the voters.
Okay. Now, given our experience since 1986, the elections that happened afterward, where we elected the president and the vice president separately, do you think that did more harm than good, given what we experienced under those administrations?
Certainly, except for the vice presidency of Noli De Castro under GMA, which was not rocky. And that's because, I suppose that's because also Noli decided not to run for president, right? So really didn't rock the boat while he was vice president. Every single vice president that we had, even when at first they were in good terms with the president with whom they were elected, you know, they never aligned with that president. They were not aligned in the campaign. Neither did they have to align during the presidency. And eventually they would break up with the president. So Salvador Laurel earlier actually broke up with Cory Aquino. And then Erap Estrada broke up with Ramos by the last year as he positioned himself to run for president and thought Ramos wanted to stay on through the amendment of the Constitution. Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo was certainly disloyal to Erap as the impeachment saga began and the process began. She distanced herself and eventually joined the EDSA 2 revolt, right, against Estrada. And then, of course, you saw that in President Aquino with with Giorgio Binay, by the third year, by the midterms, they were already, strange, even if he was still in the cabinet. Of course, we know it got the worst situation is VP Robredo.
Yeah.
When the president did not even allow an inauguration with her.
Yeah.
One of the craziest thing a president has done. One of the most, unconstitutional things a president would do is not to have an inauguration. That's the first time we ever had that. It's not a constitutional requirement, but that's expected. But I have to say, Pinoy also did something really bad, which is not make the Chief Justice at the time do his oath taking. So these things happen, right? And the system allows for it. So there you are.
Mm-mm. So in this case, for example, during the campaign for the May 2022 elections, we're seeing different groups doing their own pairings.
Yes.
For example, Isko Moreno, who is, of course, the running mate of Dr. Willy Ong, openly being paired with Sara Duterte. Before, we also saw Lenny Robredo being paired with Sara Duterte, even if they, of course, do not belong in the same ticket and they have their poles apart when it comes to their political positions, especially under this administration. So what kind of campaign are we seeing here when people are actually openly batting for those combinations because they are allowed to?
Exactly. That's my point. They are doing this because they don't like one of the candidates, but like the other. And then in the other tandem, they like one candidate. So they pair it on their own. Sometimes with a tacit consent of the or support, if not of the candidates themselves, but the campaign managers. Lito Banayo was quite interesting in Mindanao when Lito said that, it seemed clear to me that he agreed to Doc Willy not joining. And there was no choice about that, and it was okay for his court to do that. So it would be interesting if I think there was a movement that was launched today in Filipino, right? The Isko Sara movement. It would be interesting if that catches fire, and it would be interesting about how Sara would respond and how Willy Ong would respond to that. But it's okay. It's a free country, and the system allows for that. It's not good. But at the same time, frankly, does it matter, Christian, when anyway those candidates do not stand for platforms anyway?
Yeah, precisely.
They stand for ideas. That's unfortunate, right? I'm always saying that this and then even the candidates I like, they're not standing for ideas. They're not standing for rejecting, for example, the system they're standing for who they are and what they are. And they're doing that, even those that might know better, because they think that's what the voters want. Mm. The voters want them to be these personalities, that's why they're doing that. And again, I repeat, that is condescending on the voters.
Okay. Of course, that this is, of course, precipitated by the lack of a strong political party system that we have. But even then, because of these combinations and open campaigns that we're seeing, di ba, napakaliwanag people. There are groups of Duterte supporters openly campaigning for Isko Moreno and Sara Duterte. And basically, as a consequence, ditching Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., who is the choice of the daughter of the president. Doesn't that somehow set the tone already, the tone of disunity? When in fact tickets are supposed to provide a semblance of unity.
Well, yeah, that's that's clear, right? I mean, that you have groups of supporters that are... We saw that, by the way, in 2016 already in the Duterte camp when there were several... Bongbong Marcos was running with Miriam Defensor Santiago, was openly pairing himself. In that case, the candidate himself paired himself with Duterte. Of course, there was Cayetano pairing himself with Duterte. There were Robreto voters in the Duterte voters, right? So that already was there in 2016. I think it's gotten worse now. Quite honestly, it's going to be interesting because this is so far, and it by no means is the game over, and we don't know who will win the presidency and the vice presidency. But if polls are to be believed, that the tandem of Marcos Robredo, for the first time, you know, you have a tandem that actually might both win. Mm-hmm. Compared to, you know, I'm actually trying to recall, and it seems like almost all our presidents were like that. Marcos in 1965, who did win with his tandem, Ferdinand Lopez. I mean, but in earlier presidencies, there was always rivalries between the president and the vice president.
Okay, let's try to look at this issue from the perspective of ordinary voters. We know that they are allowed to pick and choose their presidential and vice presidential candidates. They're not bound to actually follow the preferred ticket of, let's say, their president or vice presidential candidate. So, for example, what would be a good guiding principle for them? That even if this is allowed under the current constitution, would it really make sense if they pick a tandem instead of actually splitting that tandem in favor of another candidate?
I suppose if they like both tandems, they like both in the tandem, and the tandem in fact represents something as a tandem, then they should go for the tandem. But that's the heart of it, diba, Christian? The tandems do not represent something as a tandem. They just represent themselves as two individuals that have ambition, that come with this background. I mean, listen, as an analyst, I actually try to listen to all the speeches that I could find online and as live as you could as possible, right? Because I want to feel what the voter does. Oh, if you listen to Marcos and Duterte, it's night and day, Christian. Night and day. Even in terms of ideas, they're not in sync.
Well, what do you mean?
I would say in the current tandem, the one truly in sync are Robredo and Pangilinan. And that's because they've been actually together for, you know, at least 10 years or more. Not just in the Liberal Party, but also in Kayanatin. And you know, they clearly have other part. This was not a marriage by convenience. Robredo actually chose Pangilinan to be her standard bearer. So that is a clear tandem, standing for the same principles, finishing each other's sentences. But you don't have... So I, following your idea, your point, I'd be comfortable for voting for Robredo or Pangilinan. But I don't think there is a logic in voting for Marcos Duterte or for Moreno. Ano, maybe the other one, pala, sorry.
Lacson and Soto. How about Lacson and Soto?
Oh, yeah. I just realized that Lacson Soto, they finish each other's sentences also.
Aside from that, they have a clear legislative agenda they have a track record to speak of, right?
Yes. So that's the other tandem that if you vote for them, in other words, these are the best case of voting for the tandem, Robredo and Pangilinan and Lacson and Soto.
How about the other tandem, Kalyo de Guzman and Walden Bello? Clearly, in terms of ideology and principles.
So I have to take that, but that's the third tandem that also is in sync, right? But Marcos, Duterte. Duterte, Pangilina, Pacquiao, Atienza, and Moreno, Dr. Willy, Ong, Moreno Ong, there is no rhyme or reason for those tandems. But again, yes, I agree. Liodi and Walden are, in fact, probably even more perfect than Robredo and Pangilinan, because Robredo and Pangilinan are more, they're comfortable to each other personally, and they're liberal party, but they also don't really have an ideology. While Kalyodi and Walden have a very clear ideology. They're socialist and they're consistent across all their positions.
We spoke with both candidates before, and I think they also mentioned this in previous interviews. I think Kalyodi himself was open in saying that they're not that close personally, but you would notice that in terms of ideology and background, they're very similar. So perhaps that explains why the tandem works.
And the other thing, of course, is they have a very clear platform, no? They have a very clear platform that's kind of consistent. I mean, I don't even consider this the Lacson Soto a platform. That's just for legislature, but that isn't a platform for governance. You're right about that. I think the Guzman, Bello are probably the best tandem to vote for if you're looking for a tandem.
Mm-hmm. Now, again, from the perspective of voters, does it really matter if their presidential and vice presidential candidates see eye to eye? Kasi laging sinasabi ito ng mga kandidato, di ba? From their perspective, for example, we've heard Disco Moreno say this. So, especially after that controversy involving his pairing with Sara Duterte during that Mindanao sortie. Sinaba after nun, di ba, sinasabi niya openly sa mga interviews, basta ako, kailangan ko si Dr. Willy Ong, kailangan kami yung pagpartnerin niyo. But again, let's flip the perspective. From the perspective of the voters, does it matter if this is your preferred candidate? Pero sila, tingin nila mas bagay ka dito.
Balikan ko doon na 'di ba, yung does it really matter since they can split the vote, 'di ba?
Yeah.
Sovereignty of the voter ito ang pinag-uusapan natin. I mean, and so you have to ask whether the tandem makes sense or not. And I go back to what I said, that some tandems make sense, some tandems do not make sense. So if someone splits the vote for Marcos Duterte and go for someone else, for either president or vice president, that's fine. It doesn't make a difference. But if, for example, you vote for a tandem that truly is a tandem, of course that makes a difference, and that's a good thing.
So the question now is, should, of course, this would require constitutional amendment. Mm-hmm. Given our experience with split voting for the president and vice president, do you think it would be better if we vote the president and the vice president as a tandem? So in short, pag pinili mo yung presidente, automatically you would also be voting for your candidate's preferred vice presidential candidate.
Rationally, I would say yes, but I would qualify that by saying only if it comes with other reforms. Because if you're going to still have a personality-based politics, if you're still going to have weak political parties, I'm okay with not choosing a tandem. Because I would like to have variety, you know, of individuals. If it's about individuals, I'd rather have variety of individuals, not necessarily in sync with each other. because of that. No? On the other hand, if we are ready, and I think we should put into place reforms, for example, that require a party-list system as the dominant way of selecting our representatives in the Congress and in the Senate, you know what it is, right? A real party-list system is not like ours. Ours is a very marginalized party-list system. That was, you know, ano lang yan, afterthought lang yan, because they had originally thought would be a parliamentary system, and we vote not for individuals but for political parties. Again, condescending yon of the constitutional framers to say, ayaw na mga Pilipino yan. Ayaw na mga Pilipino bumoto ng political party. Gusto ng mga Pilipino bumoto. Do we want to vote for individuals? And that's why we have to have district representatives. But, you know, lost opportunity, because we should have put into place a proportional political party system, which is what mature political systems do. No? You vote for your political party. You don't vote for an individual. You vote for an idea. You vote for a platform. Now, if you're able to do that, then yes, logically, your president, if you still keep the presidential system, then you should vote for president and vice president in tandem.
Okay.
But if anyway, it's going to be personality-based, I'm fine with it doesn't matter too much anyway.
Okay.
Because you might elect them, but they can still fight. Diba? Because their political party doesn't mean anything to them. Their platforms doesn't mean anything to them. You know, their ideas doesn't mean anything to them. They know it's not what got them elected. What got them elected was, you know, their celebrity, their personalities.
Okay. There's too much to digest regarding that, pero I'll switch in Filipino kasi this will actually affect the attitudes of voters. Napaka-importante na sinasabi ni Dean Lavinia, no? So perhaps, correct me if I'm wrong, even if you talk about doing tandem voting, which may be considered as a low-hanging fruit. Nothing stops the legislators from actually amending the Constitution, because that's a low-hanging fruit. But the deeper issue is, how do we achieve a very strong political party system? Paano palalakasin yung mga political parties natin dito at pati yung pakikibahagi ng mga tao doon sa mga political parties? Kasi nakatutok sa tao, di ba? I think this is a very prime example. Yung technically, I think ang party-list system natin dapat closed list, no? So partido ang pinag-uusapan, hindi mga nominado. Pero nakikita natin yung mga nominado, sino talaga nagkakampanya for their parties? At they tap certain celebrities to promote their parties. So yeah, it's a very strong reflection of the problem that Dean Lavinia has been talking about. So dito, ang tanong ko po, Dean, how far away are we still when it comes to that idea that you're talking about? We vote in terms of ideas, principles, and platforms, and not for persons.
As you said, it's actually just a constitutional, you know, change that must be done to get that to happen. Literally, it can happen in a first 2 years of a presidency. I mean, so whoever wins this presidency, this May 2022. Hopefully see how bad the system is, no? How terrible the system is, even for politicians. That in fact, it is a circus, and it has become a circus, worse of a circus every cycle. You know, this is the worst ever in terms of family and celebrity politics. And so what I wish is that we would have a president that would say, tama na, let's end this for the good of the country and propose the changes and do it on our first year of office, knowing that he or she will not benefit from it over the long term. Problema kasi ng ating chacha, charter change, ginagawa palagi sa third, fourth, fifth, sixth year. And it's always seen as, magpapa-extend ng term yan. Yun ang dahilan kung bakit nag-charter change.
Saka motivation ng presidente.
But I really think na, I think I've said this in your ano before, Christian, in your program, no? I think the system the political system and unfortunately the economic system on which it is based and underpins it, right, is just completely broken. And I wish more candidates would call it for what it is, and then give the alternative and propose the alternative that we must change this bulok na sistema.
Okay. So far during the campaign, are you hearing enough from our presidential candidates and their running mates as to how they intend to fix this broken political and electoral system that we are talking about?
Except maybe for Kalyodi and Prof. Weldon, because the candidates seem to be, I mean, I don't hear a lot of ideas being talked about in this campaign. And again, it's gotten worse. I mean, in 2016, Duterte had quite, you know, some powerful ideas, I thought.
And the political capital.
And the political capital to do it. In 2010, Pinoy had a powerful idea about corruption and poverty. I mean, here we really just have colors, pink, red, white. We have symbols, but I haven't really heard ideas being. That's why it's so the debates are so important. No, in the debates, both the presidential and the senatorial debates, I find quite a lot of intelligent discussion, and the candidates are forced, right, to come up with clear ideas and positions, and I've seen that. I mean, in the vice presidential debate, in the presidential debate, in the senatorial debate.
Okay. So, pag-usapan natin isa pang kadikit na issue po nito, no? Dean Tony. So, binanggit natin tandem voting, which can be considered again as a low-hanging fruit. Tapos yung political reform, in particular yung political parties, how to strengthen them, institutionalize them really. Yung pangatlo, of course, the issue of political dynasties. So far, I think Isko Moreno has been talking about this. Although, natatabunan din ang ibang mga issues sa pinag-uusapan po. No? Among those running for president, who do you think is in a better position to actually come up with an enabling law against political dynasties? And who do you think would be in a worse position to actually do this if he or she ends up being the president after Duterte?
Well, it seems quite clear that VP Lenny and would be in the best position together with Isko Moreno and with Leody de Guzman. They really have no interest in this, and I'm sure that they would be able to, you know, there would be no contradictions if they did that. No, I haven't heard VP Lenny speak too much about this, and that's probably because to some extent she does have political support from some of the political families, right? So, yeah. So maybe she's not one, doesn't want to rock the boat too much around that. But the worst ones, obviously, are Marcos, Duterte, because they do represent dynasties, and they're supported by many of the political dynasties of this country. So they will not be taking steps to do that. And Pacquiao, no, I mean, Manny Pacquiao doesn't really present a new politics for this country. I mean, you see the Pacquiao family everywhere now in terms of local politics and certainly congressional politics. So very bad example, actually, if he was gonna, you know, say that I want change to happen politically.
Yeah, because we see that early on in his political career, he began his own local political dynasty. No? Nakita natin yan. This can be objectively verified naman.
Yes.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Attorney Tony Lavinia, for joining us tonight on the program.
Thank you. Thank you, Christian. Okay. Bye.
We're going to take a quick break after the fact. We'll be right back.